Today we're welcoming Professor Stephan Hoeller, who is the author of a book called The Gnostic Jung and the Seven Sermons to the Dead. Professor Hoeller was born in Hungary, got part of his education in Austria, but since 1953 has lived in California, where he is director of the Gnostic Society in Los Angeles. Welcome to the program, Professor.
Happy to be here.
Today we're going to be talking a good deal about the psychologist, Jung, and your suggestion that he was a Gnostic. First of all, though, there probably were really at least two Jungs over the course of the years, weren't there? The early Jung, who was such a close associate of Sigmund Freud, and then the later Jung.
That might be an accurate observation as far as C.G. Jung's external image is concerned, but I'm quite convinced that in truth there was only one Jung, and from childhood on he was really always the same person. He was always a natural Gnostic, a knower of the things that are, as G.R.S. Mead defined a Gnostic. And in his early years he simply had associates whose orientation in many ways was rather different from his own, although there were certain convergences. As time went on and he became older and more established, he was able to reveal really more of that occult and Gnostic Jung.
I see. So then how does the Gnostic view differ really from traditional Western religious perspectives?
I would probably use Jung's approach to that definition. Jung was of the opinion that in the early Gnostic approach we had something that might be called psychological religion, or a much more intra-psychic religious orientation, recognizing that the religious mythos and the mythos of salvation pertains to the interior being of the human, rather than merely another system of belief and morality.
So the difference is one of interior religion as opposed to more exterior forms of religion then, perhaps.
Yes, that would be a fair indication.
Mm-hmm. And when Jung and Freud sort of had a parting of the ways, what was the nature of that parting? Why did they separate as they...
The actual final cause is rather interesting and relates, I think, closely to Jung's Gnostic orientation, for it concerned series of experiences which Jung had with a fantasy figure, mysterious figure who came to him in the dreams and visionary experiences, imaginative experiences, whom he called Philemon. And as Jung wrote in his autobiographical fragments, this figure brought him information, taught him concerning the meaning of symbols. And this material then was put by Jung into a book, which at the present time in English bears the title of Symbols of Transformation. And when that book was published, or probably even before that, having seen it probably in manuscript form, Sigmund Freud blew his stack, as it were. and the orientation which Jung represented in that book was totally incompatible with Freud's. And that's when they came to a parting of the ways, which was about 1913.
Mm-hmm. You had, at one time, I believe, characterized Jung as a supremely rational anti-rationalist, and Freud, on the other hand, as a supremely irrational rationalist. Now, what did you mean when you used
that? Well, of course, these are the kind of compensatory functions that so often occur in the psyche, in the mind of a human being. Freud had overtly and consciously a very rational, even rationalistic orientation, coming from the kind of background and education that he received. But on the other hand, he had an unassimilated and sort of troublesome, irrational side, which attracted him to psychic phenomena, to the occult, even to fortune tellers. Then, of course, he usually always withdrew again in terror, because his own irrational shadow was causing these manifestations. While Jung had a much greater openness toward the non-rational side from the beginning, and at the same time had a very sane and reasonable and reasoning attitude toward the unusual experiences which he had. He had the capacity to evaluate them both intuitively and rationally.
I see. So he approached the non-rational in a very rational way.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, from what you've already said, we get a sense that there was a public Jung and a private Jung, that there was a part of him that somewhat remained hidden from view for a long time.
Yes.
And eventually that became revealed with a great quantity of writing, some 1,330 pages of handwritten materials, most of which, as I understand it, was not even revealed until after his death.
Yes, of course, what you are referring to, I think, is that crucial transformative period in Jung's life, which began shortly after his separation from Freud in 1913 and went on with great intensity for a period of about three and a half years. And in that within that time period, he wrote down his experiences in a manuscript, which is usually referred to as the Red Book, because of the way it was bound in a red-colored material. And here he recounted his visionary and symbolic experiences that he was a partaker of during that period of time. And I think there is much evidence indicating that a good deal of his scientific writings were at least greatly influenced by the material that he received in that fashion. But the Red Book itself, up to this day, has never been published.
A certain amount of material referred to as the seven sermons to the dead have been published.
Yes. Yes, the Seven Sermons of the Dead was a separate little treatise that Jung wrote right at the end of this transformative and difficult period of his life. So in a sense it is the conclusion of that period and perhaps of the Red Book. And that he allowed to be published at first privately for the benefit of a limited number of friends. Subsequently, it got out, as it were, so then English translation was made of it several times, and of course in my book I also made my own translation of it. In fact, you might be interested to hear that just a few days ago, on my recent lecture tour, I met a lady who last summer was in Zurich with C.J. Jung's son, Franz, and he allowed her to hold in her hands at least a part of the original manuscript of the Seven Sermons. And she observed that the handwriting in it was a completely changed handwriting, which Jung also used in the Red Book. He wrote in a script which was quite different from his usual handwriting, and the Seven Sermons bear that script even as the Red Book did.
I see. Yeah, this material called the Seven Sermons was all written down, as I understand it, in three evenings.
Yes.
Within over a period of a couple of months.
Yes, it was. The reports vary slightly, but it was in a very short period of time. and it was preceded by various strange sort of spooky synchronistic phenomena in Jung's house. And then at a rather furious pace, he wrote down the seven sermons, which are more or less like seven chapters of this treatise. It is all written in the style and embodying many of the concepts of second or third century Gnosticism, although, of course, with a unique flavor and approach that characterizes Jung's own views.
Yes, you mentioned some spooky things going on. There were, some ghostly phenomena or something?
Yes, the doorbell rang apparently quite violently, and I don't believe it was sort of an ordinary electric buzzer, but one of the great heavy bells that really takes some force to ring. And Jung went to the door, and there was no one at the door, but he heard a number of voices saying, "We have come from Jerusalem where we have not found that which we were seeking." And then he felt as if these spirits had come into the house. And then he sat down and wrote, and of course the actual text of the seventh sermon starts with those very words, "We have come back from Jerusalem," and so forth.
Was he alone at the time?
Or no, his family was in residence, mm-hmm. and some of the children, I think particularly his boy Franz, had some very unusual ghostly dreams at that time as well.
I see.
All of which seemed to be related to that, mm-hmm. Impulse of writing the scripture.
I guess it would be understandable that he might be a bit guarded, being a scientific person,
yes.
And doing the kind of work he was. That it's not surprising he was guarded about these experiences.
Yes, it would have undoubtedly have been very damaging to his career and his scientific work if some of these. Shall we say, unusual features of his life, especially of his inner life, had been revealed in any detail at an earlier period.
Yeah, so he chose really to remain true to the depth psychology that he was working on, but these influences must have made themselves felt in some way in his work, didn't they?
Oh, yes. And he went on record subsequently stating that at this crucial period which we were referring to, he really had a choice. He faced a portentous choice as to whether he would remain within his chosen discipline of psychology, after all he was a medical doctor as well, or whether he really would have to abandon it and, as he put it, become a sort of a religious prophet. And he opted for the former choice, and this of course made it necessary for him to be rather guarded about the sources of his information.
That was the supremely rational part of him.
Yes,
operating, obviously.
Yes.
What was the content of these materials then that he was writing down during that period of time?
Of course, I feel that the majority of his the principal concepts of his psychology, of analytical psychology, at least in seed form, were present in these writings already, particularly in the Seven Sermons to the Dead, the individuation process of the psyche, the way in which the growth and development of the human psyche proceeds from its early beginnings in an undifferentiated unconscious state, comes forth into consciousness, returns, the dualities such as the anima and the animus and the relationship to each other, really the majority of the main concepts of Jung's psychology were all indicated, of course, in symbolic and poetic form, more in the form of a myth rather than as scientific theory as yet.
Yes, so this mythological material or archetypal material provided inspiration and basis for the scientific work that he was doing.
Yes, that would be very correct to say.
Now, what is the inspiration for those writings supposed to have been? Has there been any suggestion as to what was going on there? Is it anything akin to what today is referred to as channeling, or what in the 19th century was referred to as mediumship?
Certainly, Jung never indicated a connection with any such activity as far as his own person was concerned. He was very conversant with mediumistic phenomena because he wrote his dissertation as a doctor of medicine on the pathology and the causes of mediumistic phenomena. And he was very had many ideas on these, and they are for the most part not very complementary. So I think he would have strenuously resisted having his own name linked with mediumship.
Yes.
But rather he felt that these were inspirations and manifestations of archetypal material from the collective unconscious, which of course ultimately transcends the boundaries of the individual self of C.G. Jung and comes from deeper and universal recesses of being, rather like a universal mind.
Yes, a kind of an underground stream, perhaps,
yes.
that we all have some access to. Well, there was probably another source for the kinds of thought that Jung was developing, and that I gather would be the Gnostic materials, the Nag Hammadi materials. Can you tell
yes.
us something about it?
Jung had a great interest in this the early approach to religion and to Christianity that is generally called Gnostic. And he availed himself primarily sort of between 1912 and 1925, 26, within that general period, of everything that was available on that subject in published literature. But of course, the greatest modern find within that field did not come out into the open until 1945, when the Nag Hammadi Library of Gnostic Materials was found in Egypt. And of course, Jung was very interested in this find, and by a curious synchronicity, the first codex of that archaeological find that became available to scholars in the West turned up in Brussels in the early 1950s and was purchased and given to Jung as a gift on his 80th birthday. And so this was the first volume of this large and very, very informative Gnostic library that actually became accessible to Western scholars. And Jung and his associates, and of course, pressed most strenuously for the translation of the rest of these materials. And so they have been translated in full and in 1977, quite a while later, published here in America under the auspices of the Institute of Antiquity and Christianity in Claremont, California, under the editorship of Dr. James Robinson, who I think deserves eternal praise for his work, because he was also a very seminal figure in having that work accomplished.
Yes. Yes, there seems to be a very definitely a rising interest these days in Gnostic materials and Gnostic thought, isn't there?
Oh yes, definitely. And it was really Jung's contention, so I understand from various people who are still around and about who knew him, that Christianity and Western culture has suffered grievously because of the repression of the Gnostic approach to religion. And it was his hope that in due course of time this approach would be reincorporated into our culture, into our Western spirituality. I like to call it the stone that the builders rejected. which mm-hmm. has to be brought back and perhaps become the cornerstone or at least one building, important building block again. And he felt that this would free probably our culture and our spirituality for certain new steps, because we have been suffering from a great one-sidedness as the result of the repression and the neglect of the Gnostic materials.
Right. Now, it's my impression that you regard Gnosticism really as a kind of a depth psychology.
It certainly has a strong aspect of a psychological nature. Someone has called it a proto-psychology, an early psychology. But I would say that it is an approach to spirituality which contains powerful and valid and authentic psychological elements, and therefore is a really represents a way of approaching spirituality and religion which is much more compatible with modern psychology than the mainstream and rather extroverted Judeo-Christian Islamic religiosity that we are familiar with in the West and in the Middle East.
Now, you've mentioned, used the word synchronicity a couple of times in this conversation, and I was just thinking that perhaps we might talk a bit more about that, because it might be a term not totally familiar to some of our
viewers. Yes, synchronicity is a theory which Jung proposed in order to illuminate primarily some of the paranormal and parapsychological happenings and phenomena which continue to occur in human life. And it is really a most intriguing and very deep and unusual theory. One can't really give it justice in a few words, but I could say this much about it, that Jung felt that whenever an important interior revelatory expansion occurs within the human psyche, when an archetypal force rises to the surface in order to bring about a revelation of meaning to us, simultaneously in the external world available to our senses, certain phenomena occur. And these are able to reinforce the interior development. They are like signals. And we see smoke signals in the external world which catch our attention, and thereby we become alerted to an important breakthrough in our own natures. And that most of the parapsychological phenomena are of that character. They're always tied in with a certain internal revelatory development in ourselves. One doesn't see a ghost just because grandma's spirit happens to be walking through the room, but because there is some meaning for the enrichment of our present life trying to break through at that time.
So something that we see in the world becomes kind of a symbolic representation of something interior?
Yes, or at least a phenomenon occurs that has some meaningful relationship to and coincides in time with an interior development in us.
Now, did Jung refer to this, or was it somebody after Jung who referred to synchronicity as having something to do with the idea of meaningful coincidence?
No, I think the term meaningful coincidence was either coined by Jung himself or existed already in his time, when he wrote several pieces, lengthy essays on the subject of synchronicity.
So that's something that we might say, well, that was just a coincidence. There could be a deeper meaning if we cared to probe.
Yes, because these events are not connected with each other by causation, but they appear to be coincidental, but their coinciding itself is meaningful.
Yes. Now, is there anything particularly that's going on in our present time that's really significant in terms of the study of Jung's work or advancement of Jung's ideas?
Well, of course, Dr. Jung has been dead now for some time, since the early 1960s. And we have, on the one hand, of course, the continued work that goes on in the field of psychology. On the other hand, we have really the way in which Jung's thought has penetrated a number of other disciplines, such as the study of mythology, cultural anthropology, literature, and indeed the study of religion. And it is my profoundly held conviction that probably the most important contribution that Jung's thought has to make to our culture will probably not come from the strictly psychological and psychotherapeutic field. Not that his insights are not very valuable there, but his message really extends way beyond that. He was a spiritual alchemist, and really all of his ideas and all of his theories were the result of very difficult choice making, of the commingling of opposites, light and shadow in his old nature. There was a lot of struggle, there was a lot of personal distress and dislocations in his own life and his own relationship. A real existential hardship was involved in all of this work, but he continued with it very courageously to the end. And this manner brought forth all of this useful information for us who are still struggling, just like he did in his own time and in his own way.
Jung did a good deal of traveling, didn't he?
Yes, he traveled, of course, outside of Europe. He traveled to Africa, to America, especially to the United States, and to India. And all of these travels had a profound influence on his insights into psychology, particularly of primitive and alien cultures.
And what stands out for you in terms of that effect? Can you identify any specific things?
Well, there are really many, but I think one that I would mention is that he learned from these travels the great need for Western people to understand the different psychological approaches of other and of ancient cultures, but at the same time also to be careful to continue to guard our own psychocultural identity and not immerse ourselves to the point of abandoning our own traditions and our own psyche to these other cultures, because he felt that thereby we would actually negate the benefits of our understanding of them.
Well, this has been a delightful time together. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you very much. It was a pleasure.